Today we are meeting a person who is a global icon in school education, and the best part is he is from India. He was a vice principal in James Education's first school in Dubai in 1986. He was a CBSE chairman for Gulf region from 2002 to 2003. He has been honored with National Teacher Award in 2005 by former President of India, Dr.APJ Abdul Kalam. We are talking about none other than Dr.Farooq Wasil, who belongs to Kashmir, and today he is a global head for James Education, Dubai. So let's talk to him.
There are very few people who can be termed as global icon when it comes to school education. And we are very fortunate that today we are meeting one of the person. He can be termed as a global icon in school education, and he is Dr. Faooq Wasil. Welcome to Myedubag.
Thank you, Abhinav. Thank you so much.
So you have started your journey in 1986.
That's right.
You started from Kashmir.
No, I finished my PhD and then I had a very short stint of service there. And that was the time when I applied and I was just selected. 7th May 1986, I landed in Dubai.
Okay.
So we had a couple of schools that time. And then we evolved in time as the company evolved, the country evolved for that matter. And I also evolved. So if Dubai is successful, Jams is successful, so am I successful. So that means that all the things were in the right place and everyone had the intention of moving forward. And I don't regret any part of my journey. It has been a learning experience. In fact, even as now, I strongly believe that there are many things which still we haven't learned very well, because life is never too long enough. You always have some shortcomings, you always have some disappointments, in a sense that I haven't done it well.
Right.
Like say technology, it came to me at a late stage because that time there wasn't much. So therefore when you look at today, you're handicapped in using technology but not in understanding the technology.
Right.
So this has been a wonderful journey and a great learning experience. And JAMS as an organization, I can assure you that it creates an ecosystem and a landscape for learning. And human beings are designed for learning actually. Even you don't work for someone, when you move around, there's learning. I always say if education is a preparation for life, then all life has to be education oriented and all education has to be life oriented. And life is the greatest teacher of life. Why do you learn? You learn from life experiences. And experiences are not in the books. They're with walking, talking human beings. So we must, that they always say, use role models, use people who had a very strong experiential component to share with kids, show them the way, and this in a way give them a perspective of life that how they have been successful. Those journeys to be captured, schools actually of future relentlessly must pursue the relationships. Schools of the future will only be known by the relationships they will have. So that's how it is, and I am fortunate and I allowed myself to continue to learn either through taking degrees from the university or my personal effort to learn. And being an author, I have accomplished, I have written textbooks, I have written academic books.
From last 10 to 15 years, we have seen that there are a lot of changes which are happening in the education system also. And if we start up with, it all started first with the smart classes for the schools, then these days learning apps are also trending. So considering the fact that parents and the schools are also very much concerned about the screen time, so how do you see the role of technology when it comes to school education?
You see, Abhinav, the first question we need to ask ourselves, if you look at the world of the child for the last, say, 100 years or 200 years, or if you see the world as a whole for last 100 years, in what way it has not changed?
Right.
In the most significant way, the life and the world has changed. In which way the life of the child has changed, or the schools have changed? They remain the same. On the industrial model, you have still schools with the road and didactic teaching, blackboard and classroom. So what kind of reality is this? That the world has changed significantly and the schools and the classrooms are the same. And then you have the mandate of preparing these students for the future. And where we have no idea what future is like. So there's a mismatch. As an educator, when I look at it, many a time I have spoken in the forum that there are many myths about learning or education. We always say that school is the best place to learn or classroom is the best place to learn. while as the 80% of the learning is outside the classroom. So where is the enabling environment for these children to learn from outside environment? How is school linking external environment to their daily lesson, you know, transactions, daily learning? There's a myth that intelligence is fixed. When I was a student, the only way we could gauge students' performance is in terms of IQ. If I was on the lower rank on the other side of the curve, I was deemed that I will have no future and it's not my right, I will never improve. And if I was on the higher side of the curve, then I'm a genius. I'm somewhere in the middle, I will have some, you know, possibility to succeed. Now, we have a notion that intelligence is not fixed. Yeah, it's evolving. The environment plays a greater role. So learning means many things at a time, but it's not a fixed notion. And learning also has a cultural component. You know, there's a cultural context to learning, which we should not miss out. While we adopting technology, we must also understand what is the cultural implications of using technology and how best we can reach out. Technology is a reality. I always say this is the only human race which has a digital record. We have no choice. Whether you like it or not, it's going to impact you. And my, you know, belief is that I keep saying to educators, either you disrupt the environment or be disrupted. And problem is when you are not disrupting, your reaction to disruption is not going to be there. It's going to be very slow. I mean, you go back in history, between one invention and the other invention, it have been hundreds of years. And today in a year, you have multiple inventions, you know, hitting you, and then your sense of readiness is missing. And second important, critical important point is for the schools. They have to be learning organizations. You know, their learning has to be superior than the change outside the environment. Now look at schools and map schools. Does it really give you any sense of comfort that school learning is superior than the learning in than the change in the outside environment? And then also the problem with the technology will be it is going to really disrupt us in a big way. Take augmented intelligence. Take machine learning. It's getting superior. You know, it can even measure or judge your feelings. When the machine, you know, has the ability to self-learn. So we as humans then need to question ourselves where we are. So technology is a reality, you need to embrace it. And in doing so, we also need to be, you know, you cannot have a very, very limited approach. It has to be everything and anything. It can't be piecemeal because it's not waiting, you know, to impact in piecemeal. Future is no more the function of past. Because if I take my grandchild now, she's 4 and a half. Whatever she learns, by the time she is 20, all that she has learned will not be relevant. And by the time she is 40, the things she will learn, half of them were not invented even when she was 20.
Yes.
So it is evolutionary. So therefore, how do institutions keep pace? And how do they improve their learning? And then it gets back to policies, it gets back to process, it gets back to funding, it gets back to capacity building. So you have a whole host of issues. It's the reality, but what is our current status, where we are, how do we move forward? So we need to reflect on, because we still are using resources on a piece of technology which is irrelevant.
I mean, you are one of those fortunate ones who has seen global education and Indian education very closely when it comes to school education. So how do you see the difference between Indian school systems, number one, and what are your recommendations for the same?
You see, let me give an example. Example is a grandmaster. In UAE, which is not a very old country, I mean, they got freedom much later than us. And over the last 30 years, if you see the kind of development they have, you know, ensured, and the kind of education they have envisioned for their people and their expatriates, today UAE is being seen as one of the best models.
Right.
Why? Because they were quite willing and open to learn from the best practices and in letter and spirit execute them, incorporate them and also commit to those resources. The Indian schools are the biggest beneficiaries of this change.
Okay.
What they don't have here, they're experiencing there, and when they come back, they have a lot to contribute. Say school audits. In our country, what is the school audit all about? If you take Central Board of Education, ICAC,
yes.
audit is about, you know, looking at smaller checklists of infrastructure, you know.
Admin power. Yeah.
There's no in-depth audit or annual audit on the teaching learning on the outcomes. Our schools or colleges and universities for that matter, they don't certify the state, the readiness of the human beings for the industry. You may have the degrees per se does not sufficiently convince me of their skills and competences.
Right.
So I think there has to be a paradigm shift. And unfortunately what happens then, you have a large human population which are looking for government jobs. And the government jobs are based on what? On competitive exams. It's of some information and some, you know, knowledge.
Right.
It not necessarily mean that you have that state of readiness to be competitive in the environment where skill sets will have to be established. And also what happens in these times, the concept of getting a degree is losing its importance. Look at online university. So, you know, we have to give a greater push to online learning. In doing that, we have to also certain mindsets. We are not there because you have a huge lag. You have the deep principles of yesteryears. You have these digital natives and digital citizens.
Right.
There's a conflict, not a conflict, there's a generational shift. He doesn't understand his aspiration. Look at today, most of our children spend almost a lot of their time in the virtual space. Yet we want to cage them in the physical space. So where is the thinking across the educators? And also any change, any policy, any shift, you have to take stakeholders on board. You have to empower them. You have to upskill them. That upskilling is missing. While you may, okay, come with a new national policy, you may have your aspirations. What happens the kind of crowd you have as of now? So it has to be multi-pronged policy. It has to be coming with the new initiatives. At the same time, coming with the initiatives which can upskill the larger deadwood we have. You know, you see, learning of future is collaboration. And collaboration, the one is within and one is, you know, outside.
Right.
You are not a single entity anymore. You are not a private person. You have to interact with the globe, and there it is an opportunity, and that opportunity can be made through technology. We need to leverage it to the best possible manner so that our children are not left behind.
Right. So it's a very known fact that a student only spends around 8 to 9 hours maximum in the school, and the rest of the time he or she spends in the home, right? So there is also role of the parents, and the only connection which any school or any teacher do that they give the home assignments. So how do you see the role of parents when it comes to doing homework?
I strongly believe, you know, education is a three-legged thing. You have a parent, you have a child, you have a teacher.
Right.
It's a very organic relationship. They have to be instrument of influence. Suppose if the school teaches good values and they don't get reinforced at home, how do you expect this child to grow? With a firm belief that this is how the life is. So schools must make it mandatory as a matter of protocol to create a very strong parent engagement. Parent engagement is not coming to school collecting a report card. It's not only about attending a sports day or an annual function. Parent engagement in having a critical role to play in the learning of the child. Because there has been paradigm shifts in education. When we say, now it has moved from teacher-centric to student-centric. That means the ownership of learning is with the student.
The student.
So how do you make him to own the process of learning?
Right.
So in owning that process, it can only happen if we create this organic relationship where a very defined protocol. The parent sees it's his responsibility as well. The problem still we are struggling is we have a first generation parents. We have, you know, they have never been to school also for that matter. So schools need to become crusaders in terms of helping them first to understand what this engagement looks like. Suppose a parent, if he has no education, how do you expect him to help a child at home? You know, we have to think through these
Absolutely.
Many other things if you really want to create a comprehensive engagement. And this is critical, let me tell you. I always say schools will fail if they don't meaningfully, constructively engage parents.
Yes.
A successful school is one who is highly insulated and use parents as a strong source of support and commitment towards educating this child.
Sir, my last question, which I take your very powerful words which you have used in this question. I want to know, because if you look at school education, it's we can also say that it's one of the highest employment generating industry. A lot of people are coming in the education, they come as a teacher. So what is your powerful message to those people who are opting teaching as their profession?
See, I think the future profession, they must feel excited. The good news for people is that teaching will be one of the, you know, very sought after profession. But it will have huge demands. on the individuals. Right. You see, for a society at large, teacher is infallible. Teacher's mistake can never be condoned. What does that mean? That our teachers should be well learned. They should have high skills. They should have empathy. And they should love to be, because it's not an easy job. You know, if they think it's easy job, that's not the case. In a matter of time, you'll see over a period of time, there will be far more checks, balance and audits on their professional conduct. They will be asked to deliver against very strong KPIs. So there will be a lot more professional rigor attached to teachers' conduct and delivery. And in doing so, now it cannot be achieved in isolation. We have to look at teacher training colleges. We have to look at curriculum. There's a lot of deadwood in curriculum today. So what is it that teachers will be always looked at infallible, society does not condone them. Then there is also the reality that teachers over a period of time, the respect for this profession has declined. Not because people don't respect teachers. Our own, our own limitations, our own, doing, I would say. Because we haven't given the image of that we know it too well.
Right.
You got my point? So therefore, it has to be restored to its glory. And in that, it's the only teacher who can make it. Look at parallel education today in India. How is that schools take credit for great performance when every single child goes for private tuition? Why is the data available that you have got very average student in your school and they produce exceptions? There are great schools in Delhi for that matter. You ask them, can you produce a data that a weak student walked into a school without any external intervention, he has managed. So schools will have this responsibility. They must be held accountable that when a child enters the portals of the school, they have a moral responsibility in ensuring child is a success. And success doesn't mean that they have to get 100% marks.
Right.
Success means many things to many people at the same time.
Right.
You don't know, every child, the myth is that we all learn the same way. That's not the case.
Yes.
We are different individuals. We work at a pace. And schools must create an enabling environment where every child has an opportunity to excel and succeed in whatever he is passionate about.
Right.
Schools must have, the religious responsibility of ensuring that people within their ranks grow, both students and teachers. You see, even today, look at the schools that we are, the security person outside is as important as the teacher inside, because he also has a role to play. That sense of ownership has to come. It's when John Kennedy went to space station, he asked the lady who was cleaning the floor, what are you doing here? She said, I'm helping a man on the moon. So that kind of sense of ownership has to be in the schools.
Absolutely.
I think, the future is bright. We should be optimistic. Let's be optimistic.
Absolutely.
It is a new, push, and I'm sure we all will work towards it and collectively succeed.
Thank you so much, sir.
Thank you so much.
You have touched all the aspects, and we are very thankful for giving your time.
Bless you.